My group of friends had a nickname in high school. It was, "Hey nerds, get out of here." Not really a nickname, but. Squad, let's assemble. Or maybe it's the squad, assemble. Either way, the group in question is the same. Four freshman Democratic congresswomen who have become national news thanks in large part to President Donald Trump's tweets in mid-July telling them to go back to the countries they came from rather than continue to criticize the United States. Of course, three of the four squad members, Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez of New York, Ayanna Pressley of Massachusetts, and Rashida Tlaib of Michigan, were born in the United States, so go back to the United States. And the fourth, Congresswoman Ilhan Omar of Minnesota, is a naturalized U.S. citizen after fleeing her native Somalia as a refugee. What's remarkable here is not that the president got his facts wrong. That's a feature, not a glitch of, well, being him. But that the most powerful politician in the country is feuding with four members of Congress who weren't even in Washington at this time last year. So, who is the squad and how did they get here? The simplest answer to that question, I said it was simple, is that they won congressional races in 2018, all in overwhelmingly Democratic districts. Tlaib and Omar replaced retiring incumbents, while AOC and Pressley replaced incumbents by beating them in primaries. We call that involuntary retirement. Ocasio-Cortez's stunning upset of then-Congressman Joe Crowley, who was a member of the Democratic leadership team and someone regarded as a potential successor to Nancy Pelosi as Speaker of the House, was an absolute earthquake, not just in New York politics, not just in Democratic politics, but in politics. AOC was, at the time, a 28-year-old first-time candidate, largely ignored by Crowley and the national media, right up until the moment she won. And at that moment, she became, by dint of her youth, her party affiliation, she describes herself as a Democratic socialist, and her willingness to throw the occasional rhetorical bomb at party leaders, a giant national star. And her star hasn't dimmed one bit. She has almost 5 million Twitter followers and may well be the most high-profile member of Congress outside of Nancy Pelosi herself. Pressley followed in AOC's footsteps a few months later, ousting a 10-term Democratic incumbent by insisting he had not created enough meaningful change in the political system and promising that she would. Quote, "We have to be disruptive in our democracy and our policymaking and how we run and win elections," Pressley said, citing Ocasio-Cortez's earlier in the year victory as an upending of, quote, "narratives about who has a right to run and when and who can win," end quote. The four women, the squad, arrived in Washington then, not really knowing one another, although Pressley and Ocasio-Cortez had met once before. What the four had in common, though, was that they were all firsts of one sort or another. So Tlaib and Omar were the first Muslim women elected to Congress. And Omar also became the first woman to wear a hijab in Congress. Ocasio-Cortez was the youngest woman ever elected to Congress. Pressley, the first black woman from Massachusetts to ever win a House seat. So that series of firsts led to an interview featuring the quartet, as Pressley recounted recently to CBS News' Gail King. After that interview ended, the four posed for a picture, makes sense, and Ocasio-Cortez jokingly suggested that they all hashtag it squad goals, young people. And then, as Pressley explained, quote, "it morphed into this thing," end quote. It did. The squad actually emerged onto the national scene in a major way thanks to a scrap with Pelosi, not Trump. After the Pelosi-led House approved a border funding bill that liberals like the squad thought gave too much leeway to Trump to misappropriate the money, Pelosi dismissed their gripes by noting the squad was just the four people. Ocasio-Cortez shot back that Pelosi was engaging in the, quote, "explicit singling out of newly elected women of color," end quote. Whew. Now, just as that brouhaha was brewing, the president decided to shoot off a series of tweets attacking the squad, tweeteth Trump. So interesting to see progressive Democrat congresswomen who originally came from countries whose governments are a complete and total catastrophe, the worst, most corrupt, and inept anywhere in the world, if they even have a functioning government at all, now loudly and viciously telling the people of the United States, the greatest and most powerful nation on earth, how our government is to be run. Why don't they go back and help fix the totally broken and crime-infested places from which they came? End quote. Sidebar, never mind that Trump himself built a political career in part by criticizing all sorts of things about the United States, a practice he has continued while president. And sidebar, suddenly, a squad was everywhere. They held a joint press conference denouncing Trump's tweets.
The first note that I want to tell children across this country is that no matter what the president says, this country belongs to you. And it belongs to everyone. And today, that notion, that very notion, was challenged.
Trump, unbowed by the criticism of his racist tweets, kept up the drumbeat. Stop me if you've heard that before. He tweeted that he didn't believe the squad was, quote, capable of loving our country, end quote. He said they should, quote, apologize, end quote, to America for the hateful things they had said. Then this. Trump. Quote, the squad is a very racist group of troublemakers who are young, inexperienced, and not very smart, end quote. So, yeah, Trump might not think much of the squad, but he is making them much more powerful every time he attacks them. And that is the point. We make new point episodes every Tuesday and Thursday. Check them out.